Chapter 1 of The Syndic by C.M. Kornbluth. It was not until February 14th that the government declared a state of unlimited emergency. The precipitating incident was the aerial bombardment and destruction of B Company, 27th Armored Regiment, on Fort George Hill in New York City. Local Syndic leaders had occupied and fortified George Washington High School with the enthusiastic cooperation of students, faculty, and neighborhood. Chief among them was Thomas Numbers Cleveland, displaying the same coolness and organizational genius which had brought him to preeminence in the Metropolitan Policy Wheel organization by his 35th year. At 5:15 a.m., the 1st Battalion of the 27th Armored took up positions in the area as follows. A Company at 190th Street and St. Nicholas Avenue, with the mission of preventing reinforcement of the school from the IRT subway station there. Companies B, C, and D hill down from the school on the slope of Fort George Hill, poised for an attack. At 5:25, the 16 Patton tanks of B Company revved up and moved on the school. C and D Companies remained in reserve. The plan was for the tanks of B Company to surround the school on three sides, the fourth is a precipice, and open fire if a telephone parley with Cleveland did not result in an unconditional surrender. There was no surrender, and the tanks attacked. Cleveland's observation post was in the tower room of the school. Seeing the radio mast of the lead tank top the rise of the hill, he snapped out a telephone order to contact pilots waiting for the word at a Syndic field floating outside the 7-mile limit. The pilots, trained to split-second precision in their years of public service, were airborne by 5:26, but this time their cargo was not liquor, cigarettes, or luggage. In 3 minutes they were whipping rocket bombs into the tanks of Company B. Cleveland's runners charged the company command post. The trial by fire had begun. Before it ended, North America was to see deeds as gallant and strategy as inspired as any in the history of war. Cleveland's historic announcement, "It's a great day for the race." His death at the head of his runners in a charge on the Fort Totten garrison. The firm hand of Amadeo Falcaro taking up the scattered reins of leadership, parley, peace, betrayal, and execution of hostages, the Treaty of Las Vegas, and a united mob-syndic front against government. O'Toole's betrayal of the Continental Press wire room and the bloody battle to recapture that crucial nerve center, the decisive march on Baltimore. B. Aerosmith Hind, The Syndic, A Short History. No ancient history of the future has ever been written, a fact which I think disposes of history's claim to rank as a science. Astronomers quail at the three-body problem and throw up their hands in surrender before the four-body problem. Any given moment in history is a problem of at least 2 billion bodies. Attempts at orderly abstraction of manipulable symbols from the realities of history seem to me doomed from the start. I can juggle mean rainfalls, car-loading curves, birth rates, and patent applications, but I cannot for the life of me fit the recurring facial carbuncles of Karl Marx into my manipulations. Not even, though we know well after the fact, that agonizing Staphylococcus aureus infections behind the famous beard helped shape 20th-century totalitarianism. In pathology alone, the list could be prolonged indefinitely. Julius Caesar's epilepsy, Napoleon's gastritis, Wilson's paralysis, Grant's alcoholism, Willem II's withered arm, Catherine's nymphomania, George III's paresis, Edison's deafness, Euler's blindness, Burke's stammer, and so on. Is there anybody silly enough to maintain that the world today would be what it is if Marx, Caesar, Napoleon, Wilson, Grant, Wilhelm, Catherine, George, Edison, Euler, and Burke, to take only these 11, were anything but what they were? Yet that is the assumption behind theories of history which exude the carbuncles of Marx from their reference. That is to say, every theory of history with which I am familiar. Am I then saying that history, past and future, is unknowable? That we must blunder ahead in the dark without planning, because no one can possibly be accurate in prediction and useful in application? I am not. I am expressing my distaste for holders of extreme positions, for possessors of eternal truths, for keepers of the flame. Keepers of the flame have no trouble with the questions of ends and means which plague the rest of us. They are quite certain that their ends are good, and that, therefore, choice of means is a trivial matter. The rest of us, far from certain that we have a general solution of the 2 billion-body problem that is history, are much more likely to ponder on our means. F. W. Taylor, Organization, Symbolism, and Morale. 1. Charles Orsino was learning the business from the ground up, even though up would never be very high. He had in his veins only a drop or two of Falcaro blood, enough so that room had to be made for him, not enough for it to be a great dearth of room, counting heavily on the goodwill of F.W. Taylor, who had taken a fancy to him when he lost his parents in the Brookhaven reactor explosion of 83. He might rise to a rather responsible position in Alki, Horsewire, Callgirl, Recruitment and Retirement, or whatever line he showed an aptitude for. But at 22, one spring day, he was merely serving a tour of duty as bagman attached to the 101st New York Police Precinct. A junior member of the Syndic customarily handled that job. You couldn't trust the cops not to squeeze their customers and pocket the difference. He walked absently through the not-unpleasant routine of the shakedown. His mind was on his early morning practice session of polo, in which he almost disgraced himself.
"Good afternoon, Mr. Orsino. A pleasure to see you again. Would you like a cold glass of beer while I get the loot?"
"No, but thanks very much, Mr. Lefko. I'm in training, you know. Wish I could take you up on it. 7 phones, isn't it, at $10 a phone?"
"That's right, Mr. Orsino. And I'll be with you as soon as I lay off the 7th at Hylia. All the ladies went for a plater named Hearthmouse because they thought the name was cute, and left me with a Dutch book. I won't be a minute."
Lefko scuttled to a phone and dickered with another bookie somewhere, while Charles absently studied the crowd of chattering, laughing horse players.
"Mr. Orsino, did you come out to make a monkey yourself and waste my time? Confound it, sir. You have just 50 round to a chucker, and you must make them count."
He grinned unhappily. Old Gilby, the pro, could be abrasive when a bonehead play disfigured the game he loved. Charles had been sure Benny Grashkin's Jeep would conk out in a minute. It had been sputtering badly enough, and that he would have a dirt-cheap scoring shot while Benny changed mounts. But Gilby blew the whistle and wasn't interested in your fine-spun logic.
"Confound it, sir. When will you young rufflers learn that you must crawl before you walk? Now let me see a team rush for the goal. And I mean team, Mr. Orsino."
"Here we are, Mr. Orsino, and just in time. There goes the 7th.
Charles shook hands and left amid screams of,
"Hearthmouse! Hearthmouse!"
from the lady betters watching the screen. High up in the Syndic building, F.W. Taylor, Uncle Frank to Charles, was giving a terrific tongue-lashing to a big, stooped old man. Thornberry, president of the Chase National Bank, had pulled a Butch, and F.W. Taylor was blazing mad about it. He snarled,
"One more like this, Thornberry, and you're out on your padded can. When a respectable member of the Syndic chooses to come to you for a line of credit, you will in the future give it without any tomfool quibbling about security. You bankers seem to think that this is the Middle Ages, and that your bits of paper still have their old black magic. Disabuse yourself of that notion. Nobody except you believes in it. The inexorable laws of economics are as dead as Dagon and Ishtar, and for the same reason. No more worshippers. You bankers can't shove anybody around anymore. You're just a convenience, like the non-playing banker in a card game. What's real now is the Syndic. What's real about the Syndic is its own morale and the public's faith in it. Is that clear?"
Thornberry brokenly mumbled something about supply and demand. Taylor sneered.
"Supply and demand. Urim and Thummim. Show me a supply, Thornberry. Show me a... Oh, hell, I haven't time to waste re-educating you. Remember what I told you and don't argue. Unlimited credit to Syndic members. If they overdo it, we'll rectify the situation. Now get out!"
And Thornberry did, with senile tears in his eyes. At Mother McGinnis's old sod pub, Mother McGinnis pulled a long face when Charles Orsino came in.
"It's always a pleasure to see you, Mr. Orsino. But I'm afraid this week it'll be no pleasure for you to see me."
She was always roundabout. "Why, what do you mean, Mrs. M? I'm always happy to say hello to a customer."
"It's the business, Mr. Orsino. It's the business. You'll pardon me if I say that I can't see how to spare $25 from the till, not if my life depended on it. I can go to 15, but so help me."
Charles looked grave, graver than he felt. It happened every day. "You realize, Mrs. McGinnis, that you're letting the Syndic down. What would the people in Syndic territory do for protection if everybody took your attitude?" She looked sly.
"I was thinking, Mr. Orsino, that a young man like you must have a way with the girls."
By a mighty, unsubtle maneuver, Mrs. McGinnis's daughter emerged from the back room at that point and began demurely mopping the bar.
"And,"
she continued,
"sure, any young lady would consider it an honor to spend the evening with a young gentleman from the Syndic."
"Perhaps," Charles said, rapidly thinking it over. He would infinitely rather spend the evening with a girl than at a Shakespeare revival as he had planned. But there were drawbacks. In the first place, it would be bribery. In the second place, he might fall for the girl and wake up with Mrs. McGinnis for his mother-in-law, a fate too nauseating to contemplate for more than a moment. In the third place, he had already bought the tickets for himself and bodyguard. "About the shakedown," he said decisively. "Call it 15 this week. If you're still doing badly next week, I'll have to ask for a look at your books, to see whether a regular reduction is in order." She got the hint and colored. Putting down $15, she said,
"Sure, that won't be necessary. I'm expecting business to take a turn for the better. It's sure to pick up."
"Good, then." To show there were no hard feelings, he stayed for a moment to ask, "How are your husbands?"
"So-so. Alfie's on the road this week, and Denny's got the rheumatism again. But he can't tin barley it when it's slow."
"Tell him to drop around to the medical center and mention my name, Mrs. McGinnis. Maybe they can do something for him." She glowed with thanks, and he left. It was pleasant to be able to do things for nice people. It was pleasant to stroll along the sunny street, acknowledging tipped hats and friendly words. That team rush for the goal had been a sorry mess, but not his fault. Quite. Vladek had loosed a premature burst from his 50 caliber at the ball and sent it hurling off to the right. They had braked and backed with much grinding of gears to form V again behind it when Gilby blew the whistle again. A nervous youngster in the National Press Service New York drop was facing his first crisis on the job. Trouble lights had flashed simultaneously on the Kansas City, New York, Hialeah, New York, and Boston, New York trunks. He stood paralyzed. His supervisor took it in a flash and banged open the circuit to service. To the genial face that appeared on the screen, he snapped,
"Trace Hialeah, Boston, and Kansas City. In that order, Mickey."
Mickey said, "Okay, pal," and vanished. The supervisor tongued to the youngster.
"Didn't know what to do?" he asked genially. "Don't let it worry you. Next time you'll know. You notice the order of priority?"
"Yes,"
the boy gulped. "It wasn't an accident that I gave it to him that way. First Hialeah because it was the most important. We get the bulk of our revenue from serving the horse rooms. In fact, I understand we started as a horse wire exclusively. Naturally, the horse room customers pay for it in the long run, but they pay without pain. Nobody's forcing them to improve the breed, right? Second, Boston, New York trunk. That's common carrier while the fairgrounds isn't running up there. We don't make any profit on common carrier service. The rates are too low. But we owe it to the public that supports us. Third, Kansas City, New York. That's common carrier too, but with one terminal in mob territory. No reason why we should knock ourselves for Reagan and his boys. But after the other two are traced and closed, we'll get around to them. Think you got it straight now?"
"Yes,"
the youngster said. "Good, just take it easy."
The supervisor moved away to do a job of billing that didn't need immediate doing. He wanted to avoid the very appearance of nagging the boy. He wondered, too, if he'd really put it over, and decided he hadn't. Who could, after all? It took years on the wires to get the feel. Slowly, your motivation changed. You started by wanting to make a place for yourself and earn some dough. After years, you realized, not with a blinding flash, but gradually, that you were working for quite another reason. Nice gang here that treats you right. Don't let the syndic down. The customers pay for their fun, and by God, you see that they get it or bust a gut trying. On his way to the 101st Precinct Station House, the ears of Charles Orsino burned as he thought of the withering lecture that had followed the blast on Gilby's whistle.
"Mr. Orsino, is it or is it not your responsibility as team captain to demand that a dangerous ball be taken out of play? And did or did not that last burst from Mr. Vladek beat the ball out around, thus giving rise to a distinct possibility of dangerous ricochets?"
The old man was right, of course, but it had been a pucked and battered practice ball to start with. In practice sessions, you couldn't afford to be fussy, not with regulation 18-inch armor steel balls selling for $30 each at the pro shop. He walked between the two green lamps of the precinct station and dumped his bag on the sergeant's desk. Immediately, the sergeant started a tale of woe.
"Mr. Orsino, I don't like to bother you with the men's personal troubles, but I wonder if you could come through with a $100 present for a very deserving young fellow here. It's Patrolman Gibney, 7 years in the old 101st, and not a black mark against him. One citation for shooting it out with a burglar, and another for nabbing a past post crook at Lefko's horse room. Gibney's been married for 5 years and has two of the cutest kids you ever saw. And you know that takes money. Now, he wants to get married again. He's crazy in love with the girl, and his first wife don't mind. She says she can use a helping hand around the house. And he wants to do it right, with a big wedding."
"If he can do it on 100, he's welcome to it," Charles said, grinning. Give him my best wishes. He divided the piles of bills into two orderly stacks, transferred $100 to one, and pocketed the other. He dropped it off at the Syndic building, had an uninteresting dinner in one of its cafeterias, and went to his furnished room downtown. He read a chapter in F.W. Taylor's, Uncle Frank's, latest book, Organization, Symbolism, and Morale. Couldn't understand a word he read, bathed, and got out his evening clothes. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of The Syndic by C.M. Kornbluth. Chapter 2. A thin and attractive girl entered a preposterously furnished room in the Syndic building, arguing bitterly with a white-bearded, hawk-nosed old man.
"My dear ancestor," she began with an exaggerated patience.
"God damn it, Lee, don't call me an ancestor. Makes me feel as if I was dead already."
"You might as well be for all the sense you're talking."
"All right, Lee."
He looked wounded and brave.
"Oh, I didn't mean to hurt your feelings, Edward."
She studied his face with suddenly narrowed eyes and her tone changed.
"Listen, you old devil. You're not fooling me for a minute. I couldn't hurt your feelings with the blunt edge of an axe. You're not talking me into anything. It'd just be sending somebody to his death. Besides, they were both accidents."
She turned and began to fiddle with a semi-circular screen, whose focus was a large and complicated chair. Three synchronized projectors bore on the screen. The old man said very softly,
"And what if they weren't? Tom McGurn and Bob were good men. None better. If the damn government's knocking us off one by one, something ought to be done. And you seem to be the only person in a position to do it."
"Start a war," she said bitterly. "Swapped them from the seas? Wasn't Dick Reiner chanting that when I was in diapers?"
"Yes," the old man brooded. "And he's still chanting it now that you're in whatever young ladies wear nowadays. Promise me something, Lee. If there's another try, will you help us out?"
"I am so sure there won't be," she said, "that I'll promise. And God help you, Edward, if you try to fake one. I've told you before, and I'll tell you now, it's almost certain death."
Charles Orsino studied himself in a three-way mirror. The evening suit was new. He wished the gun belt was. The holster rode awkwardly on his hip. He hadn't got a new outfit since his 18th birthday, and his chest had filled out to the last hole of the cross-strap's buckle since then. Well, it would have to wait. The evening would cost him enough as it was. 5 bodyguards. He winced at the thought. But you had to be seen at these things, and you had to do it right or it didn't count. He fell into a brief reverie of meeting a beautiful, beautiful girl at the theater. A girl who would think he was interesting and handsome and a wonderful polo player. A girl who would happily turn out to be in the direct Falcaro line with all sorts of powerful relations to speak up for him. Someone said on his room annunciator,
"The limousine is here, Mr. Orsino. I'm Halloran, your chief bodyguard."
"Very well, Halloran," he said casually, just as he had practiced it in the bathroom that morning, and rode down. The limousine was a beauty, and the guards were faultlessly turned out. One was democratic with one's chief guard and a little less so with the others. As Halloran drove, Charles chatted with him about the play, which was Julius Caesar in modern dress. Halloran said he'd heard it was very good. Their arrival in the lobby of the Castello created no sensation. 5 bodyguards wasn't a lot of bodyguards, even though there seemed to be no other Syndic people here. So much for the beautiful Falcaro girl. Charles chatted with a television director he knew slightly. The director explained to him that the theater was sick, very sick. That Harry Tremaine, he played Brutus, made a magnificent stage picture but couldn't read lines. By then, Halloran was whispering in his ear that it was time to take their seats. Halloran was sweating like a pig, and Charles didn't get around to asking him why. Charles took an aisle seat. Halloran was across the aisle, and the others sat to his side, front and rear. The curtain rose on New York, a street. The first scene, a time killer designed to let fidgeters subside and coughers finish their coughing, was a 3D projection of Times Square with a stylized suggestion of a public relations consultant's office down in one on the apron. When Caesar entered, Orsino started, and there was a gratified murmur around the auditorium. He was made up as French Latour, one of the mobsters from the old days, technically a hero, but one who had sailed mighty close to the wind. This promised to be interesting.
"Peace, ho! Caesar speaks!"
And so to the apron where the soothsayer, public relations consultant, delivered the warning contemptuously ignored by Latour Caesar, and the spotlight shifted to Cassius and Brutus for their long, foreboding dialogue. Brutus's back was to the audience when it started. He gradually turned.
What means this shouting? I do fear the people will choose Caesar for their king.
And you saw that Brutus was Falcaro, old Amadeo Falcaro himself, with the beard and hawk nose and eyebrows. Well, let's see now. It must be some kind of tortured analogy with the Treaty of Las Vegas when Latour made a strong bid to unite mob and syndic, and Falcaro had fought against anything but a short-term, strictly military alliance. Charles felt kind of sore about Falcaro not getting the title role, but he had to admit that Tremaine played Falcaro as the gutsy Magnifico he had been. When Caesar re-entered, the contrast became clear. Caesar Latour was a fidgety, fear-ridden man. The rest of the conspirators brought on through Act One turned out to be good fellows all, fresh and hearty. Charles guessed everything was all right, and he wished he could grab a nap, but Cassius was saying,
"Him and his wife in our great need of him."
All very loyal, Charles thought, smothering a yawn. A life for the syndic and all that, but a highbrow version. Polite and dignified, like a pavan at Roseland. Sometimes, after, say, a near miss on the polo field, he would wonder how polite and dignified the great old days actually had been. Amadeo Falcaro's third-year purge must have been an affair of blood and guts. 2,000 shot in 3 days, the history book said, adding hastily that the purged were unreconstructed, unreconstructible thugs whose usefulness was past, who couldn't realize that the job ahead was construction and organization. And Halloran was touching Charles on the shoulder.
"Intermission in a second, sir."
They marched up the aisle as the curtain fell to applause and the rest of the audience began to rise. Then the impossible happened. Halloran had gone first. Charles was behind him, with the four other guards hemming him in. As Halloran reached the door to the lobby at the top of the aisle, he turned to face Charles and performed an inexplicable pantomime. It was quite 1 second before Charles realized that Halloran was tugging at his gun stuck in the holster. The guard to the left of Charles softly said, "Jesus!" and threw himself at Halloran as the chief guard's gun came loose. There was a .45 caliber roar, muffled. There was another that crashed, unmuffled, a yard from Charles's right ear. The two figures at the head of the aisle collapsed limply, and the audience began to shriek. Somebody with a very loud voice roared, "Keep calm! It's all part of the play! Don't get panicky! It's part of the play!" The man who was roaring moved up the aisle door, fell silent, saw, and smelled the blood, and fainted. A woman began to pound the guard on Charles's right with her fist, yelling,
"What did you do to my husband? You shot my husband!"
She meant the man who had fainted. Charles peeled her off the bodyguard. Somehow they got into the lobby, followed by most of the audience. The three bodyguards held them at bay. Charles found he was deaf in his right ear and supposed it was temporary. Least of his worries. Halloran had taken a shot at him. The guard named Weltfish had intercepted it. The guard named Donnell had shot Halloran down. He said to Donnell, "You know Halloran long?" Donnell, not taking his eyes from the crowd, said,
"Couple of years, sir. He was just a guy in the bodyguard pool."
"Get me out of here," Orsino said. "To the Syndic building." In the big black car, he could almost forget the horror. He could hope that time would erase it completely. It wasn't like polo. That shot had been aimed. The limousine purred to a halt before the titanic bulk of the Syndic building was checked and rolled on into the unrestricted entrance. An elevator silently lifted the car and passengers past floors devoted to alcohol clerical, alcohol research, and testing, transport, collections audit and control, cleaning and dyeing, female recruitment and retirement, up, 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 past sections and subsections Charles had never entered, syndic member though he was, to an automatic stop at a floor whose indicator said Enforcement and Public Relations. It was only 9:45 p.m. F.W. Taylor would be in and working. Charles said, "Wait here, boys," and muttered the code phrase to the door. It sprang open. F.W. Taylor was dictating machine gun fashion to a mic. He looked dog-tired. His face turned up with a frown as Charles entered, and then the frown became a beam of pleasure.
"Charles, my boy, sit down."
He snapped off the machine. "Uncle," Charles began.
"It was so kind of you to drop in. I thought you'd be at the theater."
"I was, Uncle, but..."
"I'm working on a revision for the next edition of Organization, Symbolism, and Morale. You'd never guess who inspired it."
"I'm sure I wouldn't, Uncle. Uncle."
"Old Thornberry, president of the Chase National. He had the infernal gall to refuse a line of credit to young McGurn." "Bankers. You won't believe it, but people used to beg them to take over their property, tie up their incomes, virtually enslave them. People demanded it, the same way they demanded inexpensive liquor, tobacco, and consumer goods, clean women, and a chance to win a fortune, and our ancestors obliged them. Our ancestors were sneered at in their day, you know. They were called criminals when they distributed goods and services at a price people could afford to pay.
Uncle!
Hush, boy. I know what you're going to say. You can't fool the people forever. When they'd had enough hounding and restriction, they rose in their might. The people demanded freedom of choice. Falcaro and the rest rose to lead them in the Syndic and the mob, and they drove the government into the sea.
Uncle Frank!
From which it still occasionally ventures to annoy our coastal cities,
F.W. Taylor commented. He warmed to the subject.
You should have seen the old boy blubber, the last of the old-time bankers, and they deserved everything they got. They brought it on themselves. They had what they called laissez-faire, and it worked for a while until they got to tinkering with it. They demanded things called protective tariffs, tax remissions, subsidies, regulation, always of the other fellow. But there were enough bankers on all sides for everybody to be somebody else's fellow. Coercion snowballed, and the government lost public acceptance. They had a thing called the public debt, which I can't begin to explain to you except to say that it was something written on paper, and then it raised the cost of everything tremendously. Well, believe me or not, they didn't just throw away the piece of paper or scratch out the writing on it. They let it ride until ordinary people couldn't afford the pleasant things in life.
Uncle!
A cautious periscope broke the choppy water off Sea Island, Georgia. At the other end of the periscope were Captain Van Dellen of the North American Navy, lean as a hound, and fat little Commander Grinnell.
You might take her in a little closer, Van, said Grinnell mildly.
The exercise won't do you any lasting damage, Van Dellen said. Grinnell was very, very near to a couple of admirals, and normally Van Dellen gave him the kid-glove treatment in spite of ranking him. But this was his ship, and no cloak-and-dagger artist from an ONI desk was telling him how to con it. Grinnell smiled genially at the little joke.
I could call it a disguise, he said, patting his paunch, but you know me too well.
You'll have no trouble with a sea like this, Van Dellen said, strictly business. He tried to think of some appropriate phrase to recognize the danger Grinnell was plunging into, with no resources, except quick wits, a trick ring, and a pair of guns. But all that bubbled up to the top of his head was, thank God I'm getting rid of this bastardly little sociocrat. He'll kill me someday if he gets a clean shot and the chance of detection is zero. Thank God I'm a constitutionalist. We don't go in for things like that. Or do we? Nobody ever tells me anything. A hack of a pigboat driver. And this little bastard's going to be an admiral someday. But that boy of mine will be an admiral. He's brainy, like his mother. Grinnell smiled and said,
Well, this would be it, wouldn't it?
Eh? Van Dellen asked. Oh, I see what you mean. Chuck, he called a sailor. Break out the commander's capsules. Pass the word to stand by for ejection. The commander was fitted, puffing into the capsule. He growled at the storekeeper.
You sure this was just unsealed? It feels sticky already.
A brash J.E. said,
I saw it unsealed myself 3 minutes ago, Commander. It'll get stickier if we spend any more time talking. You have, he glanced at his chronometer, 17 minutes now. Let me snap you in.
The commander huddled down after a searching glance at the J.E.'s face, which photographed it forever in his memory. The top snapped down. Someday, some happy day, that squirt would very much regret telling him off. He gave an okay sign to Van Dellen, who waved back meagerly and managed a smile. Three crewmen fitted the capsule into its lock. Phoof! It was through the hatch and bobbing on the surface. Its color matched the water automatically. Grinnell waggled the lever that aimed it inshore and began to turn the propeller crank. He turned fast. The capsule, rudders, crank, flywheel, shaft, and all, would dissolve in approximately 15 minutes. It was his job to be ashore when that happened. And ashore, he'd be practically a free agent with the loosest sort of roving commission until January 15th. Then his orders became most specific. End of chapter 2. Chapter 3 of The Syndic by C.M. Kornbluth. Chapter 3. Charles Orsino squirmed in the chair.
Uncle, he pleaded.
Yes, F.W. Taylor chuckled. Old Amadeo and his colleagues were called criminals. They were called bootleggers when they got the liquor to people without worrying about the public debt or excise taxes. They were called smugglers when they sold cheap butter in the South and cheap margarine in the North. They were called counterfeiters when they sold cheap cigarettes and transportation tickets. They were called hijackers when they
wrested goods from the normal inflation-ridden chain of the middlemen and delivered them at a reasonable price to the consumers. They were criminals. Bankers were pillars of society. Yet, these bankers who dominated society, who were considered the voice of eternal truth when they spoke, who thought it was insanity to challenge their beliefs, started somewhere, and perhaps they were the best thing for their day and age that could be worked out. Father Ambrosius gnawed a bit of salt herring, wiped his hands, dug through the litter in his chest, and found a goose quill and a page of parchment. He scrubbed vigorously with a vinegar-soaked sponge at the writing on the parchment, and was pleased to see that it came off nicely, leaving him a clean surface to scribble his sermon notes on. He cut the quill and slit it while waiting for the parchment to dry, wondering idly what he had erased. It happened to be the last surviving copy of Tacitus's Annals 7:1-5. To work, then. The sermon was to be preached on Sexagesima Sunday, a prelude to the solemn season of Lent. Father Ambrosius's mind wandered in search of a text. Lent, salt herring, penitence, the capital sins, avarice, usury, delinquent pew rent, fat-headed young Sir Baldwin in his tumble-down castle on the hill, salt herring now, and per secule saculorum, unless Sir Baldwin paid up his delinquent pew rent. At the moment Sir Baldwin came swaggering into the cell, Father Ambrosius rose courteously and said with some insincerity,
"Pax vobiscum."
"Eh?" asked Sir Baldwin, his silly blue eyes popping as he looked over his shoulder.
"Oh, you meant me, Padre. It don't do a bit of good to chatter at me in Latin, you know. The King's Norman is what I speak. I mean to say, if it's good enough for His Majesty Richard, it's good enough for me. What? Now, what can I do for you, Padre?"
Father Ambrosius reminded him faintly.
"You came to see me, Sir Baldwin."
"Eh?
Oh, so I did. I was hunting stag, Padre, and I lost him after chasing the whole morning. What I want to know is, who's the right saint chap to ask for help in a pickle like that? I mean to say, I wanted to show the chap some good sport, and we started this beast, and he got clean away. Don't misunderstand me, Padre. They were good chaps, and they didn't rot me about it. But that kind of talk gets about and doesn't do one a bit of good. What? So you tell me like a good fellow, who's the right saint chap to put the matter in the best light for me?"
Father Ambrosius repressed an urge to grind his teeth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.